Assalamualaikum and good day, my students. So this is chapter 9, data collection method. Okay, so these are the things that we're going to look, sources of the data. And then data collection methods, we're going to look at three methods and then ethics in data collection from two perspective. Okay, so sources of data, there's two sources of data, student. So the first one is primary data. This is information obtained first hand by the researcher on the variable of interest for the specific purpose of the study. Example, individuals, focus group, panels. This first hand data, first hand ni contoh, case COVID. Okay, orang belum ada any information, kita dapat info daripada the first person kena COVID tu. So this is the primary data, means first person bagi info kat kita tu, kita dapat info, then kita pass to orang, that is known as primary data. Okay, oh kita tengah jalan somewhere and then kita nampak accident. Okay, so that accident kita yang tengok first. Jadi itu adalah primary data lah. Okay, whereas secondary data, it is information gathered from sources already existing. Sources already existing. Contoh dia macam yang you did your literature review tu. Itu adalah secondary data. So dia kata contoh company records, government publications, analysis, websites, internet and so on lah. Macam you all tengok tu. Okay, so there's three methods yang kita akan belajar in MGT 3648. First one is interviews, observation and also questionnaire. But for you, you are going to use this, okay? Okay, so interview, there's few. The first one is personal interview. Yang ni is yang satu kepada satu or satu kepada dua yang you face to face lah. What are the advantages? You can clarify doubts. Kalau ada apa-apa soalan yang confused, you can clarify. You can pick up non-verbal cues. You can understand bila orang tu cakap betul atau tak betul through dia punya non-verbal behavior. And then high response or cooperation. Of course, high response because you are face to face, right? And then you can also have special visual aid, you can use it lah. Maksudnya kalau you nak tunjuk something, you can open your laptop, or kalau you nak demo something, you can demo kan depan dia dan sebagainya lah. Okay, disadvantage, it is high cost and time . High cost and time, makan masa dan makan cost because of satu hari you boleh interview berapa sangat kan. And then geographical limitation, certain places saja, tak boleh pergi cover a lot of places. Okay, and then response bias or confidentiality, difficult to be assured. Response bias ni mungkin you akan pilih apa respondent yang tertentu yang you rasa macam nampak muka dia ni comfortable untuk tanya soalan or something kan. Also orang yang jawab tu pun dia mungkin akan jawab based on dia rasa yang ni boleh expose, yang ni tulis lah, ni jawab lah, you know, something like that lah. Okay, and then some respondents are unwilling to talk to strangers. Kita pun daripada kecil has been taught that, right? So tak comfortable nak cakap dengan stranger. And also some interviewers are not trained . So dia tak reti nak tanya soalan, macam mana nak elaborate soalan dan sebagainya. Okay, then we have telephone interview. Telephone interview, we talk on the telephone, so it discomfort of face to face is avoided. Okay, so this one some people don't like, right? Talking to strangers face to face, so it's going to be avoided lah. And then faster and number of calls per day can be high because of on the telephone kita tak cakap lama jadi it will be the number of data collected tu banyak sikit. And of course lower cost lah, sekarang ni landline to landline or phone to phone pun almost no cost, right? Okay, disadvantage, interview length must be limited. Online tak boleh, on the phone tak boleh lama-lama. Jadi, dia pendek lah. And low response rate. Bila orang telefon tak angkat. Tengok nombor ni, tak nak lah. Ni nak interview aku lah, tak nak angkat. Okay, and also no facial expression. Dia boleh tipu lah, okay. Then we have structured observation. Structured observation ni is observation lah, pemerhatian. Okay, recording pre-specified behavioral patterns of some people, object or events in a systematic manner. Okay, contoh dia ada two types, personal observation or electronic observation. Personal observation, one person observing one object or another person. Whereas electronic observation, kita guna scanner, people meter, eye tracking, CCTV, ni semua pakai electronic observation. Advantages of observational study, data that we collect are more reliable and free from respondent bias. Apa yang kita nampak, itu yang kita tulis, betul? And it is easier to note the effect of environmental influence on specific outcome. Contoh kita tengok one person pagi dia very active, bila petang dia dah jadi very passive. So kita faham lah environmental effect, pagi dia masih kuat dan petang dia dah macam penat dan sebagainya. Alright, and it is easier to observe certain groups of individuals. Sometimes we can observe lah, duduk dalam satu office area, then we can observe few of the people at one time. So it's easy. Okay, the disadvantage of observational study. First, it is necessary for the observer to be physically present. Penat kena duduk, tengok, perhati dan sebagainya. Okay, and often for a prolonged period of time, lama, jadi penat. This method is not only slow but very also tedious and expensive. Tedious ni renyah sebab nak kena tengok satu-satu, so it can be very penat lah. Because of the long period for which subjects are observed, observer fatigue can easily set in, fatigue, kepenatan, which might bias the recorded data. Bila kita dah penat, mulalah kita pun alah tulis je lah apa-apa pun, cepat-cepatlah sikit. So dia akan create bias lah. The moods, feelings and attitude can be guessed by observing facial expression and other nonverbal behavior. The cognitive thought process of individuals cannot be captured. Cognitive, apa yang ada dalam dia punya mind, kita tak boleh observe. And observer need have to be trained in what and how to observe. Ways to avoid observer bias. Nak kena train dia pun lah. Okay, bias in observational study. Satu, data observed from the researcher's point of view are likely to prone to observer bias. Sometimes kita observe benda yang salah. Okay, so it can create this. And there may be recording errors, memory lapses or errors in interpreting activities, behavior, event. Sometimes kita tengah record dia terpadam ke, or kita terlupa something, kita nampak tapi kita tak tulis ke, you know, memory lapse dan sebagainya. So ini akan jadi bias lah. And when several observers are involved, inter-observer reliability. Bila ada 3-4 observer, saya observe dekat HR, seorang observe dekat marketing, seorang observe dekat finance. So this situation akan create reliability issue lah. Mungkin saya observe cara lain, orang lain observe cara lain kan. And then over observation of the happening day in day out over extended period of time could afflict the observers with boredom and introduce bias in the recording. Ni yang saya cakap tadi tu lah, penat sangat kan observe pagi petang, dia boleh menyebabkan sampai orang jadi bias lah. Okay, next questionnaire, the advantages is the lowest cost. Satu kertas je kan, jadi macam taklah mahal sangat. And expanded geographical coverage, boleh hantar merata-rata. Sekarang ni lagi senang lah, e-questionnaire je. And then requires minimal staff, tak perlu banyak orang untuk buat questionnaire kan, tak perlu ramai-ramai untuk bantu collect questionnaire pun. And then it can be perceived as more anonymous. Anonymous ni lebih lebih reliable lah, maksudnya macam kita tak kenal kan respondent tu, so whoever the respondent can be. So apa tu, bila ramai-ramai nanti kita tak boleh kata oh ini orang sekian-sekian, yang ni orang sekian-sekian, tak ada kalau dalam interview we can see kan. So sometimes dia boleh jadi bahaya sikit. Okay, and then disadvantages, low response rate in some modes. Orang tak nak respond hantar question ni, orang tak nak respond. No interviewer intervention possible for clarification. Tak ada orang, tak ada interviewer untuk dia tanya kalau dia tak faham. And then cannot be too long or complex. Soalan kalau banyak sangat, panjang sangat, orang tak nak jawab. And sometimes orang hantar balik incomplete survey. Hantar balik questionnaire tu tak isi penuh. Okay, now questionnaire design. Since you know questionnaire is a pre-formulated written set of question and to which the respondent records his answer. And questionnaire can be administered personally, mail to the respondent or electronic directly distributed. Boleh bagi by hand, boleh post ataupun boleh pakai email. Okay, so principles of questionnaire design ada tiga. The first one, kita ada principles of wording, principles of measurement and general getup. On principles of wording, ada few yang kita nak kena tengok kat sini lah, which is about dia punya content, dia punya wording, type, sequence. Lepas tu macam mana kita nak classify kan soalan-soalan tu. Untuk principles of measurement, kita nak make sure that all these skill codes semua ni included, especially this reliable and validity lah. And general getup ni dia punya appearance. Okay, so tiga ni tadi. Okay, principles of wording. Guidelines, the appropriate of the content of the question. Make sure content dia appropriate. How questions are worded and the level of sophisticated of the language used. Tak boleh sophisticated sangat lah language yang kita guna based on kita punya respondent. Okay. And then types and form of the question asked. Macam mana jenis soalan yang kita tanya. Sequencing of the question. And also the personal data. Okay, question and content. So, first we need to have a framework. Kita nak guna berapa section. Section A, section B, section C contoh. Yang ni pasal apa? Demographic data, ni pasal IV, ni pasal DV contohlah. So, kita kena ada framework. And then kita nak kena ada measurement or operationalization. Setiap soalan tu mesti kena boleh measure, boleh diukur. Maksudnya soalan tu nak reflectkan apa. Dia mesti kena related to our research objective and our research question, okay? Okay, and the language and wording of the questionnaire. The language of the questionnaire should be approximate the level of understanding. And then the choice of words will depend on satu educational level. And then usage of the terms and idioms in the culture. Terms and idioms, dia punya logat lah, dia punya bahasa lah kena tengok. And also the frames of reference of the respondents. So, apa-apa pun kita nak tengok background of our respondents lah. Okay. And the language and wording used should be appropriate to tap the respondents' attitude, perception and feelings. Kena faham, kena bagi soalan yang more natural, neutral. If not, dia akan macam effect dia punya persepsi. Okay, and then types and form of question. Kita nak close or open-ended question. Close question student is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Dia hanya boleh pilih. Okay, kalau dia rasa dia sangat suka, dia pilih 5. Kalau dia macam tak suka, dia pilih 1. Okay, open-ended question. Dia bagi soalan. Okay, this is your question. Then you bagi area untuk dia jawab. Ni macam structured question lah. Okay, so untuk closed question, it helps respondent to make quick decision and help researchers to code. Mudah lah untuk researcher pun nak pilih jawapan dia nanti kan. Okay, and then kalau open-ended, unbiased point of view, ada banyak pilihan jawapan. And it is good bila kita nak complimentary to close question. Contoh kita tanya soalan kat sini, kita nak compliment kepada dia, kita tulis satu lagi soalan. Contohlah, do you like to go to the movie? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Lepas tu, why? Itu you buka tulis untuk dia tulis. Itu contohnya. Positively and negatively worded question. Instead of phrasing all question positively, it is advisable to include some negatively worded question as well. So, the tendency in respondents to mechanically circle the points toward the end of the skill is minimized. Okay, ni contoh student you tengok I feel I have been able to accomplish a number of different things in my job. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's say saya bulatkan yang 5. I don't feel I am very effective in my job. So, kalau kat sini saya bulat 5, sini by right saya akan bulat 1, betul? Kalau saya tak baca, saya akan bubu je lah semua 5. Kalau saya bulatkan sini 5, then kita akan boleh tahulah orang ni baca atau tak baca. Faham kan? That's why dia kata sometimes kita kena ada positive and negative questions. And dia kata the use of double negative and excessive word like not, only, ini kena avoid lah because dia akan confusekan our respondent. For example, coming to work is no great fun. No great fun kenapa? Kenapa tak kata terus macam it's not fun or something lah kan? The rich need no help. Why? Only the rich do not need help. We can put it in a easier sentence untuk mudahkan orang faham. Okay. And then question wording. Okay, in question, bila kita buat questionnaire, these are things yang kita kena pay attention. The first one, avoid double barrel question. Double barrel ni, dia ada dua soalan dalam satu soalan. Contoh, do you think there is a good market for the product? And that it will sell well? Satu soalan, dua soalan. Contoh, saya rasa, dia produk ni tak adalah very good market, tapi it can still sell. So sekarang kat sini saya nak jawab 2, sini saya nak jawab 5. Next saya nak jawab apa? Because it's one question, that's double barrel. Avoid ambiguous questions and words. Ambiguous ni sama-sama or confused. To what extent should you say you are happy? Soalan macam tak jelas kan. How, what do you mean by happy? Happy at the workplace? Happy at home? Or happy in general? Susah nak jawab. Very ambiguous. Avoid recall dependent question. Recall dependent question ni is question yang perlu orang ingat balik. Contoh, question might require respondent to recall experience from the past that are hazy. Benda yang dah lama dah eh. Answer to such question might have bias obtaining the information through personal recalls. So kalau yang macam dia nak kena ingat ni, contoh, what were you doing at this time 3 years ago? Of course lah tak ingat kan. Avoid leading or biasing question. Tak boleh lead orang or biaskan orang dalam soalan tu eh. Contoh dia bagi kat sini, don't you think that these days of escalating cost of living, employees should be given good pay raise? This is confirm-confirm lah. Kalau 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, confirm-confirm orang akan jawab 5. So you are already leading people to answer 5. This is not a good question. And then avoid loaded question. Loaded question ni question yang berat lah. Okay, dia macam menyebabkan our emotion is charged. Questions are phrased in an emotionally charged manner. Should I stay or should I go? Do you think he's cute? Why this kind of questions? Should I stay or should I? Macam memang very emotionally driven. Do you think he is cute? Also, it's an emotionally driven question. So this kind of question is no good question. Okay. And then social desirability. Dia social desirability ni macam apa tu, kita nak manipulate or discriminate satu group of worker or group of people. Contoh dia bagi sini eh. Do you think that older people should be laid off? Kat sini kita kata older people kena diberhentikan kerja. Ini kita nak kata group of older people lah. So this kind of question tak bagus. Ni bias question. And then length of the question. Tak boleh terlalu panjang eh. Dia kata simple and short question are preferable to long ones. As a rule of thumb, a question or a statement should not exceed 20 words. Kalau boleh itulah. Jangan panjang sangat. Okay, next, question sequence. Question sequence ada an approach or a technique known as the funnel technique. Funnel ni macam tunnel lah. Tunnel kan daripada kita jalan besar, bila kita masuk dalam satu tunnel lah, terowong tu dia jadi kecil kan. So, sama juga. Funnel technique, daripada corong yang besar ni, kita pergi ke sini jadi corong yang kecil. So, when you buat soalan, you buat easy question to difficult question or general question to specific question. This is known as funnel technique. Classification data or personal information. Last but not least, kalau untuk buat questionnaire ni, kita kena be careful bila kita nak collect information on the demographic question. Okay, question yang tak berkait, jangan collect, okay? Macam age, educational level, marital status, income ni okay lah. Unless it is absolutely necessary, it is best not to ask for the name of the respondent. Tak perlu. Name of the respondent tak perlu minta. Question seeking the details of income or other highly sensitive information is deemed necessary as best placed to very end of the question. Kalau perlu sangat-sangat baru minta, kalau nak juga minta bubuh at the end of the questionnaire. Kalau tidak, orang dah tak nak jawab dah dia punya questionnaire. Okay, such information should provide a range of response rather than seeking actual figure. Kalau soalan macam ni, minta income, jangan minta actual figure tapi minta range. Okay, contoh dia. macam ni. Or age. Age pun ramai orang sensitif lah. So minta macam ni better. Okay, principles of measurement. So bila kita buat questionnaire, make sure questionnaire tu ada apa, goodness of data. Goodness of data ni is dua benda ni lah, validity and reliability. Saya dah ajar kan, validity ni how well a technique, instrument or process measure a particular concept. And soalan tu mesti kena measure concept yang kita tulis tu. And contoh kalau soalan pasal IV, pasal IV1 ada 6 soalan, semua mesti kena berkait dengan IV1 lah. Okay, reliability, how stably and consistently the instrument taps the variable. Stability and consistently, semua orang faham soalan tu secara sama. Okay, general appearance or get up of the questionnaire. Make sure questionnaire tu attractive and make sure ada good introduction. Bila nak buat, nak jawab questionnaire, kita akan baca eh. Kalau intro dia menarik, orang akan move. Kalau questionnaire tu cantik, tersusun elok, orang akan jawab. Kalau tak, that's it, your questionnaire tak ada orang akan layan. Okay, so this one dia punya summary, so boleh baca nanti. Now, ethics in data collection. So, ada dua, ethics of the researcher and ethics of the respondent. Ethics of the researcher first. Treating the information given by the respondent as strictly confidential and guarding his or her privacy. Itu first, mesti kena treat semua maklumat confidential. Number two, jangan, respondent should not, the researcher should not misrepresent the nature of the study to subjects, especially dalam lab experiment. Yang ni kita tak buat student eh, tapi kalau ada research yang masuk dalam lab experiment, kita tak boleh manipulate apa tu, the purpose lah, kena maklumkan kepada kita punya respondents tu. Okay, and the personal or seemingly intrusive information should be solicited, and if it is absolutely necessary for the project, it should be tapped with high sensitivity. Yang macam pasal gaji tadi apa semua tu, kalau tak perlu, tak payah minta. Okay, whatever the nature of the data collection method, the self-esteem and the self-respect of the subject should not be violated. Mesti kena respect. Walaupun lah kita collect data daripada makcik kat kampung pun, pun kena. Okay, no one should be forced to respond. Ha, yang ni, kalau kita bagi questionnaire, orang tak nak jawab, no problem, kita cari orang lain. And non-participant observer should be as unobtrusive as possible. Non-participant observer ni adalah those orang-orang yang tak join kita punya questionnaire, tak join as kita punya respondent, dia kena duduk jauh. In lab studies, the subject should be debriefed with full disclosure. Ni yang saya cakap tadi tu, kalau kita buat dalam lab, subject ni kena tahu dengan apa yang akan berlaku pada dia, apa yang research ni pasal apa. Subject should never be exposed to situation where they could be subject to physical or mental harm. No one should be harmed when we are collecting any data. And there should be absolutely no misrepresentation or distortion in reporting the data collected. Jangan tipu data. Collect 20 tapi reportkan dia sebagai 50-60. Jangan tipu. Nanti bila outcome dia, kita akan tahulah menipu tak menipu. Okay, then ethical behavior of the respondents. The subject, one having the choice to participate in a study, should cooperate fully. Kalaulah kita dah pilih untuk participate, kita cooperate. And the respondent has also has an obligation to be truthful and honest. Dah setuju untuk cooperate, jujur lah. Okay, so that's all for this chapter. Alright student, bye. Assalamualaikum.